Thank you, Dr. Baycoat. It was an awfully fun conversation that early summer afternoon at Honey Rock, and I was just so amazed that you were interested. I love talking about Church of the Resurrection. I could talk about Church of the Resurrection all day long, but not many people, including my wife, even after a while, want to listen. So it was wonderful to engage, and it was wonderful the way you, through your questions, really did surface the story of reconciliation and unity. And I think we have lived in that story. We forget what a noteworthy story it is. As a matter of fact, we forget that it's really only by the power of God that the three of us would be sitting next to each other on the stage right now, when we wouldn't even talk to each other, when we would assiduously avoid one another, were we to see one another across the aisle in a duel. It's just truly a work of God that not only can we sit here together, but we work closely together literally every day or every week in this part of a larger movement that we call a planting, a revival of word and sacrament infused by the Holy Spirit, an Anglican diocese. So let me just start us with prayer and even just a word of thanksgiving for what God has done and what God may do through all of us to further the gospel ministry of reconciliation. Amen. So let's pray. Father in heaven, we just are here struck by the power of the cross. We're struck by the reconciling work that you have accomplished once and for all in the atonement of reconciling sinful humanity with the living God. And we ask, O Lord, that we would be imitators of you, and that we would imitate your work of reconciliation. We would imitate your work of fighting for unity. And I pray that our conversation this evening might catalyze those who are irreconciled into reconciliation, might catalyze those who need to have that hard conversation directly with another brother or sister to have it. Lord, that it might catalyze in our own hearts as we're sharing a deeper hunger and courage for reconciliation. These things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, as we were chatting about it, it seemed like it might be most helpful to start with how the division happened. I don't think we should spend a whole lot of time on that. And honestly, we feel like it's not necessary to bring out every single detail of that, nor do you want to. One's reminded of a dog returning to its vomit. Those were bad years, but they were years that happened. I think it's important to clarify that and bring that out. And then I want to say a little bit about, in the same way how the division happened, how the unity happened, and then hand off to Valerie and to William, and then we'll just probably be dialoguing among us, as we often do, and Dr. Baycoat will guide and direct us like the good shepherd that he is. All right. Really, the story starts, I think, in a very important way, in a division that occurred that we now, 24 years later, would say was a really important division. So let me start with the good division in our mind, and then there followed from there actually four very painful and unnecessary divisions. But the necessary division started actually in 1993 when we, as an Episcopal church, we were part of the Episcopal Diocese of Chicago, through several course and events, became clear that our bishop had made concrete and public decisions to no longer live under the authority of Scripture. And in our tradition, while a bishop has great authority, their authority is always sourced from biblical authority. And when a bishop makes a decision to abdicate biblical authority, so, and this is true in all the great traditions, but especially in Anglicanism, where the Word of God has clear primacy, that when a bishop makes that decision, they then have really abdicated their own authority in abdicating biblical authority. When it became clear, again, publicly, we were not poking around to find out if this was true. It was a public reality, both in his writings as well as in his sermons and statements, that this was the case, that he was truly coming out from underneath biblical authority. Canon William, who was then the senior pastor at Resurrection, I'm currently senior pastor at Resurrection, but Canon William was then senior pastor, led us through a very deliberative, a very humbling process where we started with actually a liturgy that was developed to confess our own sins and to realize that, A, we had been complicit in the sins of our greater church, that we were certainly complicit in sin by our own sinful natures and sinful decisions that we had made, and began a season of repentance on our own that led ultimately to us honorably but clearly confronting the Bishop of Chicago at that time and asking if he would consider repenting of his public statements that separated him from the clear biblical witness. And Father William led that process. The bishop chose not to do so, and we became clear that actually a division had already occurred. And let me just tell a quick story about that, and then I'll move into the other divisions. But I think, again, it's important to start here, because this division was a division over biblical authority. This division was a division over the understanding of the nature of the church and over the understanding of church authority. And I would want to hasten to add, when we talk about a lot about reconciling, there are some things that scriptures say should not be reconciled, particularly when there is a clear departure from biblical authority. There we don't reconcile. So just to tell the story briefly, it became clear to us through his teachings, but it also became clear to us in an event that had a particular supernatural import to it, that we needed as a sign from God that it was right for us to do something so radical as disassociating from your bishop. That was not done lightly. That was done with great grief. And it was actually an event where we, the clergy were lined up to start the service, and Father William was there, and the bishop was there, and he was in the back of the processional line, as is our tradition. And there was a table that was set with the elements for Holy Communion, bread and wine, grape juice for Wheaton College students. And it was all there on the table, and it was in a glass carafe with the wine and the basket with bread. And while they were preparing to enter in, the table, without being touched, because no one was near the table, they were just lining up alongside it, but they were about 5 feet away from it. Without it being touched, the table literally collapsed with the legs coming in from underneath them. And in the collapse of the table, the carafe that held the wine hit, it was soft wood where they were lined up, and it actually shattered. It didn't just crack, it shattered. And the bread, the basket that held what we call the host, which would be the bread that would be consecrated for Holy Communion, fell and rolled to the feet of the bishop. For us, that made clear what we'd already discerned biblically, and we discerned as a community, became clear supernaturally that communion was broken and that there was division that had already occurred between the bishop and the scriptures and the church and the scriptures. Okay, so that was the first division. But that, again, I would argue, now with 25 years hindsight, was a healthy division and one that actually released us into very important gospel years and gospel work. Although it was not without its challenges, going without a bishop, as we did then for 7 years. But then, unfortunately, even though we had great growth in that season, and we had left the Diocese of Chicago and the Bishop of Chicago, what began to happen is a kind of leadership culture began to develop, and there's still questions as to all of how this happened, but there was a leadership culture that began to develop that was a kind of elitist culture. It was a highly easily threatened culture. It was a defensive culture, and it was a culture that took a page from the playbook of how we had worked it with the bishop and tore that page out and put it in a different playbook, which was the playbook how to work through things with those that you agree with biblically and theologically but aren't getting along with, as opposed to the playbook how to work through things with people who have abandoned biblical authority. And when you pull this page out of the playbook and put it in this playbook, you have a recipe for the disaster of what we experienced, which was four church divisions in 4 years. They started in 1997. April 1997 we're in almost our 20th anniversary of that first major division. And three other divisions followed after that, 1998, 1999, and 2001. It is absolutely stunning that a church called Church of the Resurrection and meeting in Wheaton, Illinois, it's absolutely stunning that it even exists any longer, that she even survived all of those four divisions. It was very confusing for the sheep because, again, when a division would occur of these four, that we would ask, and at that point I was not pastoring, I was a member of the church, we would ask, well, what's the heart of the conflict? What, is there a biblical disagreement? Is there a a philosophy disagreement? Is there a church disagreement that we just don't know about that you could somehow explain to us why our number two leader, for example, 1997, is leaving the church and 300 people are following him? Or why our senior pastor, Father William, was really pushed out in 1998. It wasn't voluntary that he left. He was pushed out. I was actually at the heart of pushing him out. And I'll say more about that, much to my own shame and later need for significant repentance. And they would say, well, why did Father William leave? And we found we never had good answers. Because the fact of the matter was, it was all interpersonal. It was all emotional. It was all personality-oriented. We could never point clearly as we could with the Bishop of Chicago and say, oh, well, this is why. In the Bishop of Chicago's case, he's supporting active homosexuals in their lifestyle and in ordained ministry. We could point to that, and there was black and white writing about it. We had none of that. And so the difference between what happened in 1993 when we made that decision, and there were not everybody left. About 15 people stayed and 400 left the Episcopal Church. But even in that, there was a clarity to it. It was painful, but it was not brutal compared to 97, 98, and that was brutal. Because there was never this clarity. It was always just interpersonal confusion, interpersonal fog that was a part of that. So driving it was this kind of dysfunctional culture, but also what was driving this was that Resurrection had very rapid growth in the 90s. We were a conservative Anglican. We weren't fully Anglican at that point. We didn't have a bishop, but we had a prayer book worship, and we were conservative, a sort of Anglican style of worship church that had an Anglican heart, and we had very rapid growth. Which is unusual for many churches, and it's especially unusual for Anglican Episcopal churches. It just doesn't happen that often. And as that happened, I will speak just for myself as a member of the church at that time, that became a matter of incredible pride. And we began to think that we were something special. Valerie and I were the same age and same generation. We were serving under Father William and Anne. And I know that Catherine and I would often say, wow, isn't it great to go to such a special church? Must be so hard to go to a normal church where they have divisions and they do potlucks and, you know, just all that, you know, whatever. I mean, we're not a normal church, you know. We're something much more special. And the fact of the matter was, God was doing something very special at Resurrection, and it was a beautiful time, but we somehow, in our sinful nature, almost took credit for that and internalized that in a way that really created an incredible sense of elitism among other churches in the community, elitism in regard to our tradition, and it was noxious. And I personally believe that one thing that happened in light of that, and I can only speak into my own heart, but I know that I was clearly there, is that as the writer of Hebrews says, I think that part of what also happened besides our leadership culture is that judgment begins with the household of God. And I think God, in his love for Resurrection, judged Resurrection. Now Valerie and William may not share that opinion. That's just my perception. And maybe it's wrong. But that was my perception at the time. And it certainly led me to begin to really evaluate what I had bought into and what I had perpetuated and what I was a part of. Finally, the division happened in significant part because we just refused to work through conflict. We just didn't want to do it. Like, you know the horrible feeling you get when you know you have a conflict with somebody? And you walk around all weekend thinking I have that conflict with somebody, and you even, like, forget for a while, and you go, oh, why do I feel bad? Oh, yeah, I have a conflict with somebody. Your heart beats faster. Your palms feel sweaty. You don't want to think about that person. You can't stop thinking about that person. You know, it's like having an emotional canker sore where it just won't go away. Well, we were having those experiences across the board. We had so many conflicts going on, but what we weren't doing was following the scriptures like Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 18 and going directly to the people we had conflict with and saying, we have conflict. This is horrible. Can we begin to have a conversation about this? We just weren't doing that. I can't imagine what would have happened if we'd had social media in 1993. It's possible the resurrection wouldn't have made it. I'm not sure we would have made it if we'd had that tool. But we certainly had the telephone, and it's also just great to talk to the people about other people, which is what we did a lot of. I mean that ironically. It's not great. But we wrote letters. Yeah, we definitely wrote letters. We use a thing called the fax machine, which sends a letter through some kind of cable across houses, and we there were like really nasty faxes that got sent. Really crazy faxes. Some of them like steaming, and they were green and steaming. They were so nasty. And so we did all of that, but we rarely sat down with each other and actually just tried to have a conversation with each other. And we certainly didn't bring in a third-person mediator, a third-party mediator who could sit down with us. We certainly didn't go out beyond ourselves because we were special and get somebody in the larger community to come help us. We didn't do any of those things. And so our division really fomented, and because we just kept dividing and there was no clear public repentance of our division, it just kept happening. And again, it started in 97 and it went all the way through 2001. And those were very, very difficult and very, very challenging years. Let me say a little bit about how unity happened. And I think I should just, because my guess is even when I've said, Father William and Deacon Valerie are going to have thoughts about that. But the first way that at least I was awakened out of this nightmare of constant divisions is something that I'm not proud of, but I think it's important to articulate, because this is how we started fighting for unity. Is the only reason I started fighting for unity is that I became the object of division. People began to divide against me when I became the senior pastor in 1999. And after 2 years of that, and people sinning against me, I finally awakened after I'd been sinned against and realized the very sins being committed against me is the very sin replicated that I committed against my own father in Christ, Father William. Now, I didn't see that I'd done that to Father William on a prayer walk. I wish I had. I think I could have. I didn't. I was in too much self-deception. I didn't see it reading my Bible. And I was reading my Bible every day. I was deceived. The way I saw it is that people did it to me, and I went, wait a second, this is horrible. This is hell. This hurts like crazy. This is a horrible thing these people are doing to me. And I went, oh my goodness, I did the same thing to William. And then I awakened. So unity can begin with sin against us. That's how it started, at least for me, and what catalyzed my new thinking. Then I went to the scriptures. After that happened, I went to the scriptures and I went, wait a second, did I perpetuate this? What do the scriptures say about this? And the verse that came out to me again and again was Romans 12, verse 18. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. And I realized I am probably in a crisis of Christian peace with probably 30 different individuals. And I was totally overwhelmed by that realization, including Father William, including Valerie, and many others. And I realized I'm not at peace with them. And so I just took that scripture verse for what it said, and it said, as far as it depends on you. And for Catherine and me, what we realized is we have to get to the point where we're more interested in reconciling with people that we have hurt and that have hurt us. We're more interested in that than in being understood ourselves. We're actually more passionate for reconciliation than we are in having that person across the table that we're reconciling with, being able to articulate perfectly everything they did to us, which is what we were holding out for. But we realize as far as it depends on us. So all we can do is name what we have done, rather than waiting for them to name what they've done. I was waiting years to finally get that letter from someone that finally said, these are all the things I did to you. I thought, okay, now I'll forgive them. Or I even thought I'd forgiven them, but now I'll reconcile with them. And for us, that was a massive and really important gestalt. I mean, there we went, wait a second, let's flip this picture. What if we entered into a relationship with people who, these are not apostates. These are folks that love Jesus. They're serving the gospel. That's clear. But we're hurt by them, and they really hurt us, or we really hurt them. What if, as far as it depends on us, what if we stepped into relationships and said, let's be reconciled, even if we can't be fully understood? And that opened up a massive place of freedom in us and opened up literally probably 24 conversations with people saying, here's what I did to you. Is there anything else I did to you that I don't know that I did to you? Can I just say how intimidating it is to have a conversation like that? Because actually, if you let them tell you what else you did to them, they'll often tell you. And it was really hard because you're already like you're coming humble and you're saying things you did. And then you say, well, what else did I do? And they said, well, as a matter of fact, here are the things that you did. And you had to remember things you said. I mean, you have things repeated back to you that you said that you actually remember saying, but you wish you could forget that you said them. It's so alarming how deep our sinful nature can be when it's reflected back to us. And we went through that process. And it was extremely, extremely humbling. And I'm very thankful, though, at the end of the day that we did. Let me conclude and then hand off to these guys. I would say it was our own sin that helped us see that we sinned against others. It was the Scriptures. And then it was the power of the Holy Spirit. For example, when I came to the realization of what I had done to Father William, much to my shame even to this day, that I would treat really the man that led me back to Christ after years away from Jesus, that I would treat him like I treated him. I couldn't believe I'd done it, but I had. I had done it. And I'd been part of a group of folks that worked hard to push Father William and Ann out of our church. When I realized that, by the providence and the supernatural design of the Lord, I was getting on a plane to go to a meeting, and I was at Midway, and it would just be by God's design that Father William was also at Midway. Do you remember this meeting? And we actually saw each other there in the food court there in Midway. And now a year, 6 months before, if I had seen him, I would have hoped he hadn't seen me and gone to my gate. I mean, honestly, I would have done everything I could to avoid seeing him. And he wouldn't have done that. I think he would have been glad to see me, or at least willing to see me. But now I was ready. And we ended up on the same flight, going to the same meeting. None of us knew that was the case. And supernaturally, because God wants Christians to be reconciled with one another, he planned it, and we stepped into it, and I was able to begin a series of repentances. I mean, I started repenting, but then I got clear. The more we talked, the more I'd done, and I had to go back and repent more, and it was like a piece of art that I just kept, you know, adding new layers of paint to just how much I had failed him and failed the Lord, failed the gospel. And we began to do that. That was stunning. I would add then that Val and I also had a process we had to work through in our reconciliation. And one of the supernatural things for me in my memory, and my memory may not be totally clear, is that one of our clear interactions was right before Holy Week. And for us in our tradition, and I think for many of us as believers, of course, Easter weekend is extremely important to all of our lives. And at Resurrection, Holy Week has always been core to us. We were planted as a church in Holy Week 1954, and so Holy Week is the week in our lives. And the fact that Val would reach out with her heart for repentance, as I'd reached out to William with my heart for repentance, was very striking that happened at that time. I'll conclude with this, that one of the key steps that in all of this was, as the Spirit led us, is we actually were led to have a reconciliation service. And it was one of the most important, probably spiritual events of my formation. It was a service that was held on Pentecost Sunday, when we praised God for the descent of the Holy Spirit and the inauguration of the church as we know her. And we had an afternoon service on Pentecost Sunday where we were clear that any of us who had irreconciled relationships and broken relationships, for example, Church of the Great Shepherd was planted out of Resurrection during that season by Father Lyle Dorset, and Father Lyle and Mary Dorset were there, and Catherine and I were there, Father William and Anne were there. There were about 100 people gathered at that afternoon service where we were going to get up in front and we were going to publicly repent of how we had hurt one another in front of each other. We were going to articulate it, and we did that. And then what happened spontaneously, and I think this is key to unity and reconciliation, is that it became clear that we needed to honor particularly our spiritual father and mother that had really inaugurated this entire movement that we're still a part of with Father William and Anne. And we repented of dishonoring them, and then there was just a beautiful moment of asking them to come forward. I think we laid hands on them, and we rightly honored them for the spiritual father, spiritual mom that they were to us, the leaders they were to us, and we set that in order. And I think that's key to unity, is not only, first and foremost, respecting the authority of the Scriptures, but it was then respecting where we had disrespected the authority of our pastor and his wife, who God had placed in authority over us as Peter talks about in 1 Peter and as the book of Hebrews talks about. So we had disregarded our authority, and now we were properly regarding them. And I think that that moment and that time actually has since catalyzed a series of events and fruit in the life of our churches that I actually go back to that moment there. I'll add finally, there were two physical healings that night. And we weren't praying specifically for physical healing, but somebody had a word of knowledge that there would be a physical healing. My experience, one of them, I had significant lower back pain. And it's one of the few times I've experienced very tangible physical healing. But in that service, we were unifying around Jesus, the cross, and the forgiveness of sins, the healing power of God broke out. I think that's powerful when you think about the book of James, where it says, confess your sins one to another, that you may be healed. And we experienced that scripture verse with profound embodied reality. And I personally bore that in my own body when my lower back pain was, in that case, instantaneously relieved. So praise be to God. That's just some of that, how the division happened and how the unity happened. Let me pass over to Val.
So I want to say a little bit about the interior work. Stewart's talked about his interior work, and there's some really interesting parallels as well in his story as mine. Just a little bit of background. I graduated from Wheaton in 1988, and 1989 was in the fall. After I'd been married, we started going to Resurrection on Wednesday nights. So Father William was absolutely a father in Christ to me. I think maybe I went there twice before he was like calling me to serve and to be involved, really blessing and affirming me that call to ministry. So this is, you know, this is a very formative time in my life. And I was also right in the center of things. William and I were part of a prayer group that met every Friday afternoon for kind of a long time. It was a very vulnerable thing. Also, many of us had families that didn't live in the area. So the community that we had in this leadership circle was very familial. We spent holiday meals together. I mean, it wasn't just like a professional working position. When these relationships broke down, it wasn't just a professional breakdown. It was a deep interpersonal deterioration and collapse of love and relationship that went very, very deep. And I was also then, I'm the kind of person, everybody tells me everything. So I was always hearing it from both sides also. And I developed a very interesting kind of poker face where sometimes you couldn't tell whose side I was on. That's not a good thing. Eventually, that was very, very destructive in my soul. I was part of the last. I mean, I was definitely complicit in all of these things. I had a very similar experience when I was praying one day when all of a sudden I realized what I'd done to William. And I just remember, I mean, I'm not a big crier. There were a lot of tears. And I knew I needed to do something. And it was difficult because at that time I was still in very close relationship with sort of the party that had been against William. And it was really tough to say, I'm going to go and say, I'm sorry to William, even though my friends were like, well, I don't know about that. It was very difficult. And it was just the beginning. It was just the beginning. So I was part of the final movement of division in 2001, and so I missed out on that awesome reconciliation meeting because I would have been off somewhere scorning you probably. But it's interesting. I remember actually very vividly on the one hand being like, yeah, you're all galvanized together around a common enemy or it was some kind of narrative like that. But also thinking, wow, I wish I was there. So it took me a long time to work through that. Let me just say a little bit about the devastation that this brought to me. I really agree with you about feeling under judgment. I remember at some point realizing, this is the judgment of God. Mm. I don't feel far from God. I don't feel unloved by God.
Right, right.
But I feel there's a movement that is judging my inner heart. And a couple of things happened. One, there was real depression that happened because I was allowing so much duplicity in my soul. So about 3 years later, still related to the same conflicts, I then became the object of criticism in a way very similar to the way that Stewart and William had. And I had written many of these terrible letters. I call them letter bombs. It's sort of like, you know, they're full of shrapnel. They're like a dirty bomb that you send, and it like sends out shrapnel that lodges in the heart and in the mind and the memory of those who read. And I had helped write those things. The one that was written to Stewart, another person, she was the main author, but she wanted me to sign it from both of us. Mm. And I was like, well, could this just be from you? But I did help. I still helped. And then one day, one of those letters was in my mailbox. And I thought, wow, there's no stamp on this. Someone had to deliver it. Someone was the hatchet man. I used to be the hatchet man. Now I'm getting the letter. And you would think that would be enough to get me moving, but I was so so stubborn, and I'm just so aware that it's really the Spirit of God that melts the heart of stone and makes it a heart of flesh, and I really needed a work of the Spirit to soften me. A couple of things happened that were really helpful for me to get some movement in my interior life. The first was we had a mutual friend who was dying of brain cancer, John Fawcett. And there was a healing service for him, I don't know, maybe 6 months or so prior to his passing. And it was the first time I saw it on Facebook. So this is the good of Facebook, I guess. And I thought, you know, it would be cruel for me to not go to that healing service. I mean, what does that say if you're like, I'm mad at those people. I'm not going to go pray for that man's healing. I mean, I couldn't bring myself to that kind of lack of charity. And with some criticism from the people that I was still with. And when I was sitting there, I was aware that my heart had hardened because I was sitting in a room full of people that I still loved and that I knew still loved me. And I looked at them and I thought, you know, I wanted to grow old with these people. What happened? And it stirred that process of our friends dying and the realizing that just the shortness of life, all of those things, you know, there's only a limited amount of time with which we have to set love in order. So that helped the grief of that. The part of the judgment for me was I moved into a place of great isolation because I lost my main sort of fellowship group and I was too proud to go back to where I'd come from. And in that place of isolation, of grief, I did a lot of praying. One thing that happened when I got really quiet before God is that two things came up in my heart. One was the grief. You know, all of these relationships that had meant so much to me that were family relationships, that my life was the poorer. My heart was impoverished because I'd let go of the love. And so the grief and the love started stirring together. I think that was really the work of the Holy Spirit. In that place of feeling judged by God, I also felt deeply loved. I knew myself as a loved sinner, and I could feel these almost like a counter movement of pride and of fear. So I also was meditating on the same passage from Romans 12, as much as it depends on you. And it just put me into a, you know, almost like doing a moral inventory. Where can I make it right? And I started making phone calls. I called my old prayer partner, and it had been 2 years, and I left her this tearful message, you know, I'm sorry, I blew it, can we talk? Another mutual friend who had been such a mother in Christ to me, I left her a message, you know, can we talk? And so I started having these conversations, one painful conversation at a time. It's really a process. It's not an instantaneous kind of thing to rebuild unity. And even after those conversations, it takes years to rebuild the trust. When trust is destroyed, trust has to be rebuilt. The work of unity is a work of rebuilding trust. Just a little anecdote that was so encouraging to me that I was on the right track. My husband and daughter and I, actually we had some great church experiences in between. We were away from Resurrection for about 7 years, but we were at a church called Life Church, and that was a wonderful home for us, and we were quite involved. I preached occasionally, and we were close with the leaders. And while we were there, I really started to experience this sense that God was leading us to go back to Resurrection. But by this time, I was aware that that could actually be a really selfish decision on my part, and that I might actually hurt people at Life Church if I did that. So the one thing I didn't want to do was just disappear some Sunday and then get a call 2 months later, we haven't seen you in 2 months, Val, where are you? So we had a very transparent process with the pastor and his wife, and we had this wonderful meeting. Stewart and I had a couple of reconciliation meetings by that point, and he said, you know, it'd be really great to have a conversation with the vestry, which is sort of a governing board for an Anglican church. And he also encouraged me to write another kind of letter, sort of like, this is my penance. You know, your penance should match your sin. So you wrote these terrible letters that caused harm, so how about writing a beautiful letter to bless, which I did. And so we had this meeting, and it was really lovely because our pastor from Life Church came with us, and we were able to pray for one another, and then when we left that church, like, I preached on the last Sunday, and it was so wonderful to have this sense of, like, this was an open, transparent process. Nobody's getting hurt here. They might miss me, but there's not hurt. There's no harm. There's no leaving, you know, with guns blazing. The risk involved, I think, was the hugest thing for me. There was pride. I was just very, very proud, and I wanted to be right. And eventually, the desire to be reconciled and to love had to get stronger than the need to be right. I finally realized, you know, we will not actually resolve this by being in a courtroom with it's not going to happen that way. This is not how conflict is resolved. It's not resolved in the courtroom with a prosecuting attorney and a defense attorney, where we come to a judgment about who was right and who was wrong. That's not forgiveness. That's not reconciliation. And so that's where all my pride was. I can't tell you how many hours I spent running these things around in my mind, where I always came out the one who was right. I realized it was a dead end. I'm never going to figure out who was right. Everyone was wrong. Everyone was sinning. I let go of that. And the other was fear. It's just the risk. You know, what happens if I reach out to Stewart and say, can we talk? Will you forgive me? And he ignores me. But I could then, at least in the integrity of my own heart, say, I have done everything I can. Everything I can. As far as it depends on me, I have done what I can to be at peace with all.
This is this. Thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes.
This is an accurate reflection on reality because I always need someone to help me with where the mic really is.
That's kind of the theme of your life.
That's true. Exactly. And it's just powerful to hear Stewart about your sharing, and it's beautiful. I remember being young at Resurrection, and the church was really taking off, and it was really glorious. And I remember very specifically, we had a gathering of leaders, and we had come across this incredibly wonderful prayer, and we prayed it with all of our hearts. And the prayer went basically like this: Lord, wherever there's any dross in us, wherever there's anything in us that's amiss, shake it from us, drive it far from us. And we prayed it so fervently. And you know, the Lord answered the prayer. He's really merciful. After many years after that first time praying it, I will pray that prayer at points and say, you know, Lewis is being undragoned, to say, Lord, there's things in me that's just got to be undragoned. You've got to shake some things loose. But please, in your mercy, do it very gently, please. So the prayer's changed a bit. The need of the Lord hasn't changed, but the prayer has changed a little bit. After this kind of breaking had happened in relationships, I had someone share an image with me and said that, did you know that when a bone is broken, at the place where it heals, it's actually stronger than it was before? Now, there's some doctors here. I don't know if that's really true or not, but it should be true if it is, if it isn't true. Because what happened in all of this is that we got stronger as well. But for me, it was very confusing to receiving these faxes. And it was almost unbelievable what was happening. And in the going through it, I didn't understand what was really going on in very profound ways. And it took a few years on the other side of it to begin to grasp some things. But one thing that I began to see was my own part in it, the ways that I had sinned against other people, and the ways that I needed to repent. And so when we were going through this with the diocese, it's a little bit like Galatians 1, right? It's Galatians 1, Paul is seeing red when it's a gospel issue. If anyone preaches to you another gospel, even if I preached it to you or an angel from above, let them be anathema. He says it twice, anathema. He is seeing red, and he is prophetically making a distinction between good and evil, light and dark. And we really had to face into a situation like that in the church. And praise the Lord met us. And to God be the glory, because he met us as we were asking him to kind of shake loose from us all the dross. Of course, I didn't, and I don't think any of us saw the dross, right? We didn't, you know, maybe there's a little bit. But to understand the depths of how desperately we need God and how desperately wicked we are is a grace of seeing reality of oneself. But it was really painful, this whole process. And I remember as I was starting to see that the way I'd sinned against people, I knew one thing, and one thing only. I knew I needed to go to any person that I has sinned against and confess it. I also began to realize quickly that the long list that I had of the ways that they had sinned against me, they probably didn't see that themselves. And I realized I had to let go of it. And that what I had to do was to confess what I knew. And to let go of ways that I had been, that I had perceived that I was sinned against. And of course, what helps me and all of us is the cross. Is to go to the cross with the ways that I had been sinned against to Jesus, and then to ask in mercy to be able to extend, to ask forgiveness to others. And it is very humbling, you point out, well, because there's things that I didn't fully see that people said, well, you know, you remember this as well. But that was a, that was also full of healing and of grace. And then as we met at Midway, there was another time that we were scheduled to get together. And I was living at the time in the North Shore of Chicago and then driving to meet with us, with Stewart. And this has never happened. I'm driving down the Eisenhower, and the hood of my car flipped up, and I could only see by scratching down, it was like 3 inches of sight. So I had to pull over and put the hood down. And I remember that the meeting felt so charged because we were just starting to talk to each other once again. And it was this picture that, you know, we also fight against powers and principalities. However you describe why that happened, it was a moment of, there was a struggle to press through. And that struggle to press through is very real. And it's willful. It's not, a lot of being woken up for all of us is because someone came against us and we realized how we had hurt other people. So a lot of the waking up was because we saw what we did because someone was doing the same thing to us. And then we had to learn how to extend to extend an asking for forgiveness. And one of the things that's really very powerful now, if you're with Stewart and Val, they're very quick to go to people one-on-one. And they're very quick to work things out relationally in the Lord. And we, there was a lot that we had to learn together as a people. You know, I wouldn't change anything. You know, as you're talking, as I'm remembering, but really, as you get to the other side, what happens is that you just realize what it's like to be with Stewart and Val. And it's almost like this fog of illusion that came over the relationship goes away, and what is real is back, and it gets stronger as we keep choosing the Lord, and it gets stronger as we walk together. And it was at this time that Philippians 1 became very powerful for me, because Philippians is, in contrast to Galatians, where Paul's saying, read it at the beginning of Galatians, Philippians 1, Paul is in prison. He's giving thanks to God that he's in prison because the Praetorian Guard is now coming to Christ. And he's in this circumstance that most of us would think be very discouraged by. And then he writes in the first chapter about how he's hearing that there are people that are kind of coming against him out of rivalry and out of envy. He doesn't actually use pleasant words, but he then says, I thank God because they are sharing the gospel, and if they are sharing the gospel, that's what matters. That's the basic argument. And then you go through the rest of Philippians. You remember how much Jesus humbled himself. And then you've got two sisters that are fighting each other. And he is exhorting them to remember that we, Paul and the sisters, are partners in the gospel with Christ. And it was in that moment of reading and meditating on Philippians that I realized these are all brothers and sisters. And no matter what I think or interpret, we're brothers and sisters. And I rejoice that the gospel is going forward. And that really then was a bedrock for the reconciliation service where we had, and that was an important public service to have. Because all of this took place in public, and the Lord has met us. So, to be honest with you, I don't really dwell on the things that we're talking about tonight. So much has come forward after and in the fruit, but it's good to learn. And certainly our hearts would be, for all of us here, is to take very seriously what it means to walk with brothers and sisters in Christ. And that the unity is to be guarded. And the going to one another quickly is how we guard that unity.
Thank you. So you talked about how we got here. One of the things that you were also sharing is, of course, you've arrived at this reconciliation, but that reconciliation isn't a static thing. I mean, it's also moving into something. Could you say a little bit about what it's moving into?
I'll start with a few comments, and then Father William will share even more, because there's been a few different ways in which this has manifested itself. First of all, at least in Resurrection's culture, we've been very clear from the beginning, and in our membership process, we've been very clear that unity has to be fought for. So you can't assume unity. You have to actually fight for the unity of the church insofar as be willing to go directly to one another, be willing to have the courage to repent. And so we actually, as part of our membership process, have a unity pledge that we ask folks to sign where they commit to working through unity in biblical ways and to honoring biblical authority and honoring church authority. So that's been one really important fruit, and God has tested that in our life together, and I pray we've met that test in terms of always trying to fight for unity as clearly and as powerfully as we can. I would say that another piece of this has been, as we've come to do this, we've fallen in love with the church. I think as we reconciled within the church, and we reconciled as the church, and we fought for unity as the church, we've just had this sort of profound affection, conversion, if you will, to the life of the church. The church is a she and not an it, and that she can be loved, and that you can be devoted to her. And that that's then led to us wanting to plant churches. Because when you love her so much, and you love people that are far from God and the marginalized and the unseen, then you love the church and you love them. All you want to do is get more churches to them, because you love her. And so this unity and this reconciliation engendered love for Holy Church, which has actually engendered now an incredible love and a commitment to starting churches. And so that's, I think that our unity battles and the victory we gained in the Lord and his cross has actually catalyzed what we now are experiencing as a kind of church planting movement, particularly around a commitment to planting word and sacrament churches that are full of the Holy Spirit because of that. So I would say that this just our own church culture, and then planting churches that actually come not so much out of going to a conference where they said you should plant churches, and we said, okay, let's go plant churches, but instead years of fighting for her unity and falling in love with her. I'll keep this one. You have your own. We like to share.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why don't you describe your coming to the True Freedom Service on last Sunday? Yeah.
Well, we were chatting with Vince about it and just kind of reflecting on what God has done in this kind of unity passion and unity, contending for unity. And it occurred to me as we're talking that another fruit that we're seeing besides the church planting is we're beginning, especially in our diocese, to see that unity among believers of different ethnic backgrounds and racial backgrounds, which is a hunger that so many of us, I know, carry in our hearts, and a huge personal hunger of mine, personally. And so Father William, through a story he'll tell, basically has begun to build a really profound, close partnership with an African-American church in Oak Park where he pastors. This church was meeting across the street from where Father William was meeting. And this relationship is developing to the point where these African-American brothers and sisters are actually asking the question, what would it look like for us to become Anglican? And we're only so glad to tell them that actually in the global Anglican world, whites, the minority, the Africans and the Asians and the Latinos are, by God's grace, by far the majority. And that led to an invitation to have a chance to preach at True Freedom, which is a part of a group of churches that Father William leads that not yet become Anglican, but they're a partner church. And they gave me the privilege of preaching there. And it was such a profound sense in the Lord of unity. It's a profound sense in the Lord of together beginning to contend for the unity, not just among brothers and sisters where relational breakdown has occurred, but where societal structure and racial realities and the history of our own country has conspired to bring deep division, and to see that beginning and that overflow that started begin. And we are certainly at the beginning, but what a beginning it is.
So when you look at a city like Chicago and live right now in Oak Park, which borders on Austin, and if you kind of peer into Austin and the west side of Chicago, it is filled with storefront congregations. And it's a very different world. What if the Lord in his mercy shows us how to have unity with brothers and sisters in our city? Because right now, people are pretty much in different orbits. But what if reconciliation in the Lord is what brings healing? What if the gospel has the power to touch Chicago now? And what does it mean that we are the people of God, recovering our call to be reconcilers, and to humble ourselves with one another, to confess our sins to one another, and to follow the Holy Spirit together? Don't we long for that? Isn't that our heart's cry? There's fruit in the gospel, because only in the gospel can we really partner and be on equal footing at the foot of the cross. Only in the gospel can we know this kind of deep reconciliation, where we're looking first to God on the cross and receiving his humility towards us and forgiveness, and then we can see brothers and sisters in a different light. So that's why I say I'm so thankful to the Lord, because he's opening a door. And this whole story is just the beginning of a door that's opening.
questions for our guests? Please, yes.
So while you're gathering the courage to go stand at the microphone, I'll say just a little something more about unity and the expansion from this. I have really asked the Lord, like, how can I avoid ever falling into that kind of destructive way of relating with my brothers and sisters? And one of the things that has been very, very helpful to me from Ignatian spirituality is the idea of consolation and desolation, and understanding what that feels like in my thoughts and my feelings. Consolation, that which comes from the Lord, means my thoughts and my feelings point me towards an increase in faith, hope, and love. So if my thoughts and feelings are oriented in that direction, towards greater faith, hope, and love, not just towards God, but towards others, I know that's a sure path. If it's desolation, it's a decrease in faith, hope, and love, not only towards God, but towards others. And this has been so helpful to me when we have this this fear of the other, of that which is different than other than us. And one of the things I'm very passionate about is ecumenical unity, especially with Roman Catholics. And we forget sometimes in Wheaton that we live in a predominantly Roman Catholic area. And so I've been praying for a long time for opportunities to build actual relationships with people who are Roman Catholic. And so often when I actually, here I am face to face, you know, with a young Jesuit priest or something, and I feel that longing for connection, and there's consolation there. There's this increase in faith, hope, and love. You know, should I reach out? Should I make that phone call? That's the direction that I want to go. And it seems like if we listen to the Holy Spirit, if we follow those impulses towards building up faith, hope, and love, the kingdom of God goes forward. And it's pretty simple. In really tangled, complicated relationships where we're tempted to fear. When I'm tempted to fear, I'm like, oh, well, I'm just not going to go there. I will err on loving and believing and trusting the other. And that has really, out of this, like, Lord, how do I avoid falling into such a pit ever again? That simple principle has also proved very fruitful for me in ecumenical conversations.
So a question that comes to my mind as I'm thinking about this, and thinking about our current culture that is driven more by fear, that seems to catalyze more division than unity, what do you find helps people to have the courage to enter into reconciliation?
Well, that's such a good question. And obviously, the minute you ask it, I think of our political dynamics. That's just where my head goes first. But of course, we've got so many dynamics where this is true. And I would say, reflecting on my life now and my experience in this season, I think that for me, as a believer, I became more afraid of not living by the scriptures than of going to that person and repenting or of confronting them. So I needed something greater than myself that I had put myself under, so that I'm going to be afraid either way, so I guess I was just working my fear, if that makes sense. I think I got more afraid of having to answer to God that I hadn't done everything I was able to be at peace with all people. I really hadn't. And I think I became afraid of that disobedience. And honestly, that in part drove me. And I would say, even when I in privy from time to time to conversations and listen to folks in places of power talk about things. I haven't had many of those, but I've had a few, and I'm always thinking there must be something very complicated here, which is why they're not getting along. There must be something very intellectually nuanced as to why they're not getting along. And when I have been a part of those conversations, I'm always stunned. No, actually, it's a lot like fifth grade, and so-and-so said something to so-and-so that hurt their feelings, and now so-and-so won't go to so-and-so. Forget their titles. Forget the letters behind their name or in front of their name. They just got hurt by somebody, and they won't work it out because they're afraid of conflict. And so I think that it's that courage that comes with something greater, and that courage to actually have a vision that on the other side of that conflict might be the mended bone that's stronger than it was before.
Oh, could you go to the microphone? Because I know you're right in the middle of the aisle, but this is being recorded, so.
Val, you used a phrase that I'd like you to tell us a little bit more about. It went something like, I allowed too many duplicities in my soul. Can you talk more on that?
Yeah, I mean, the duplicity came really from wanting to be esteemed and thought well of by everyone, even when they were on opposite ends of things. And what it meant was I was one person in one crowd and another person in a different crowd. And little by little, I would compromise what really mattered to me. And so my sense of self got smaller and smaller to the point where I didn't know my own voice. The need to be silent instead of to be quick to be so quick to agree with others, to be able to ponder, to make that kind of room, and to be able to live in the discomfort of feeling like, wow, I really have a disagreement with this person, that's okay. But it was that kind of duplicity that really just comes from the desire to be highly regarded by everyone. And unfortunately, eventually, sometimes you do have to make choices. You know, I mean, I knew when I made the choice to reach out in reconciliation with Stewart that there were going to be those that disapproved. And that fear of God, you know, is so important. And that really is an increase in faith, hope, and love. Because when we act because of the fear of God, that is a great act of faith, that we actually trust that, you know, if we honor the Lord first of all, if there are those who misunderstand, if there are those who reject, it's going to be okay. That I can live with that.
Yeah, I'd love to add something that's, I'm sure, just obvious, but it seems important, and we haven't surfaced it in this conversation, which is the place that anxiety plays in conflict and lack of unity and lack of reconciliation. I mean, those years that when we lived in that, I was just constantly anxious. I was anxious all the time. And I think I didn't understand how to have that, as Dr. Friedman describes it, a non-anxious presence in the face of conflict. Conflict meant anxiety. And often in them, what kept being experienced is more conflict, but more anxiety. And actually what we've begun to discover, which has been so freeing, is working through conflict can actually mean less anxiety, which is very rewarding, particularly if you feel anxiety a lot.
I'm curious to hear what happened among the churches under you during this time, and in hindsight, how God may have used this to build and grow his church.
First of all, yes, it... the church is always watching, and our children are watching. My daughter, who's here, was about 5 when we first left Res, and I remember these very unpleasant conversations when she'd say, "Well, why aren't we going over to so and so's house to play anymore?" And I would have to say, "Well, you know, we, you know, Mrs. Smith or whatever, You know, she said some things that, you know, were really disrespectful and hurt my feelings. You know, and a five-year-old is like, well, can't you just say you're sorry? it's like, yeah, you know, out of the mouth of babes. You know, so it's not only the churches that are watching, but children are watching. You know, and I do think of what is the generational impact? You know, if I'm sometimes in pastoral care with people who be like, you know, they'll narrate to me, you know, six or seven churches that they dragged their children to over time, and each one they left with a conflict. And it's funny how those kids aren't really interested in going to church, because it really has such an impact, not only on a destructive impact, and on the other hand, when we reconcile, it's so encouraging, it's so empowering, it's so emboldening. It gives courage, I think, to those that we lead when we reconcile.
I would also add that at that time, fortunately, we didn't have many churches under us. So Father William planted a church in 98. Rez planted her first church in 2003. So in a way, there was a mercy there that we weren't spreading our disease. Instead, what God did graciously is that by the time we started planting, we've been working through reconciliation. And now the churches that we have planted, we have about 30 churches in our diocese now. Most have been planted through Father William's work or resurrection of churches that have been planted, have an incredible passion for unity. So we've been blessed that we didn't spread the bad part. And what God's now taught us, that there is a kind of hunger. We were just together as clergy and spouses at a retreat last week, and the hunger for unity and the commitment to unity is palpable. And that's a fruit, thanks be to God. So.
Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for the story, because it is rare, as Vincent mentioned, to hear this kind of story, and your honesty blesses us. I wish that that more of these stories, which happen all of the time, and you know, the ways that I've been complicit in things like this that have happened, that the world would hear more of these stories that are just hidden away in people's memories, and that shape them in all different sorts of ways all the time. But it's unspoken. So thank you. And then my question is about the place of love in seasons of discord, like you've described. I heard at least one comment from you, Valerie, and maybe another comment as well about, I realized, like in my eureka moment, that I loved these people who I had been hurting and who I had hurt. But I'm trying to imagine the nature, I guess, of this conflict, of this discord, when love is still, when you're saying love is still present. You know, the world might narrate a story like this and say, reconciliation is the moment when I was able to replace my hatred for someone with love for them. But you're saying, no, love was a continual reality. But where was love in that, and what was happening to love in, like, through this process? Does that make sense?
Can I jump in there? There's a basic choice that we all make of how we see other people and how we see a person that we're in conflict with. And the more that we begin to see another through eyes of love, asking God to give us eyes and to maintain that, you then, I think, start to treat the person with that love. So there's a bit of a conversion, right? So if we're through a season, it's really awkward and we're just avoiding each other. There was this moments of transformation where we're actually starting to treat one another how we actually love them. And that reality is what the reality is for eternity. And it becomes what then takes over. And so it, to me, the choice between bitterness and love is very real. And we all face it all the time with relationships. And it's a willful choice. And that that love can triumph, because there is no opposite to love. And God is love. And God will empower us. But the moment of choice is often, especially when we're highly in conflict, it's just very confusing. And our hearts are going all over the place. And but that is the choosing to love. Love God and love your neighbor. And to see a person through God's eyes. And then treat them as you love them. Regardless of how another person might respond.
I don't know if someone who understands psychology better than I do would have to comment on this, but I think when we are in conflict, I hope this makes sense, I think we actually repress the love, because if we lived in the love, we would not be able to live with ourselves. We would have such an internal conflict. Yeah. The love is pressed down. I mean, I think many of us experience this, you know, in other kinds of hurts as well. You know, if you have a hurt with a parent and all you can remember is that, and then as you forgive, it's almost like the love that has always been there starts to resurface and resurge. There is something about sin, about bitterness, about pride that it like puts a lid on love. But it's still there because God is love. The Holy Spirit, I mean, we have the Holy Spirit in us activating that. But we can choose to be, not tap in to that beautiful stream of the Holy Spirit that holds us together.
One thing to observe about that Father Williams said earlier was you use the word fog to talk about the situation. Right, and I think that's another way of thinking about the repressions, like that fog where you're not seeing the love. I mean, it may be there, but the fog is clouding your vision. So what you see is the fog. I mean, is that kind of fit, do you think?
Yeah, well, I mean, yes, because what ended up happening is you had to choose not to love. And when you start choosing not to love, it's so destructive to your soul. Because we did love one another, and we received such life from one another, and yet we were so hurt, we made the choices not to love. And it created a one-dimensionality that was very frightening.
Does anyone have a final question? Yes, ma'am.
So to kind of get to the genesis of how something like this begins, starts rolling out, it sounds like what I'm hearing is it starts with confusion. And I mean, for me, like I feel like we're in a really confusing time where Christians are split on things that I would have never dreamed or imagined. My friends who are taking stands for things that I completely disagree with, and it's so confusing. And so I do feel very tempted to kind of cut off my heart and stick to my principles. And so I guess what I'm wondering is that, you know, your first red flag, the fog, the confusion, like, okay, I'm feeling really confused, so I want to grab hold of something I know instead of grabbing hold of the love of God. So that's, I
it's hard, this call to hold fiercely onto love and to let the Holy Spirit do the work. I mean, I think in parenting, it's when it's most obvious, you know, you have to let your kids come to their own genuine conclusions at a certain point. And we do that in all our relationships, where we have to wait in a place of faith and continue to love fervently while we wait for them. It's like, do we really trust that the Holy Spirit is in charge and that he loves unity? Do we really trust that? I think when we lean on that, it makes it easier to keep loving, even though we're deeply grieved because of our principles.
Yeah, it seems that you kind of have to discern the confusion in some ways, right? So the confusion can come because you're actually facing into what is divided, perhaps among Christians at times, like we talked about in our very first instance of division, where there was division. We hadn't created the division. The division was there, and it was confusing at first to encounter that. But actually, as we reflected on it and as we did our Bible work, we actually realized, wait a second, we were confused because this is somebody we loved, admired, our bishop, and yet we're not in the same place. And so then actually the confusion dispelled. So there was a discernment around that confusion. It became clear this is a confusion that led to clarity because there's a greater reality, which is the scriptural authority that we can depend on. It was interesting how the confusion that descended when we all went into conflict, which wouldn't lift, that just didn't lift, and there was no Bible way out of it. Actually, the Bible way out of it was to reconcile with each other. So I do think that it's the scriptures that can kind of be that compass that ultimately help us emerge from the fog and from that initial confusion that comes no matter what kind of conflict is there first. There's just confusion. And sometimes maybe the confusion is important because there is division and we need to accept it. Other times the confusion is important because the division is wrong and we need to overcome it. It's a great question.
And there's genuine repentance. So you, where there was pride, where we said something, we sinned against one another, those are things we repent of so that we might be free.
And if you ever wonder about the triumph of love, you would just want to talk to Father William. It's these really blue eyes, and he will say something like, love will win out. And he will just look in your eyes, and he will tell you this with all of his being will shine through his eyes at you. And you will not exactly understand how it's all going to work out, but you will believe it. You will receive it. You will live into it.
Well, yes, please. Yes.
If love is not overcome, love will overcome all things. He was getting at that thought. And I want to say that word of hope, because love does overcome. That's the story. That's the reality. And so we've shared pain, but love does overcome. And it's true for you as well.
Yeah, wait, would you close us in prayer?
Lord, we thank you for your gospel. Amen. We thank you for sending your son to us wretches, us sinners, and we thank you for dying for us, for taking on our sin and our sinful nature. We thank you for the resurrection and the power of the resurrection. We thank you that you have overcome sin and death. We thank you that you've sent your Holy Spirit. You've breathed life upon us through your Spirit. So, Lord, pray that in this night, for anything that may have been stirred in hearts, pray, Lord, that there would be your healing touch. I pray for hope. Lord, where there has been hopelessness, I pray that you would breathe the word of hope, that all things are being reconciled to you. And Lord, pray that there would be any confusion dispelled, fog lifted. We pray, Lord, for any here tonight that need to go to a brother and sister and to confess or to reconcile, we pray, Lord, you give them courage and the blessing. And Lord, we cry out to you for your bride, your church, throughout this whole Chicagoland area and indeed in throughout North America and the world. We pray, Lord God, that you would lead us and that we would grow in your unity, Lord, that you would be seen because people see you in us together. So Lord, join our hands together. Join us together. And may your son be glorified and be lifted up. For we ask these things in his name. Amen.
Deacon Valerie McIntyre, Bishop Stewart Ruch, Canon William Beasley, thank you so much for telling this often untold, often unheard kind of story. Glad it's being recorded. May it spread abroad and encourage many others. And thank all you for coming. I appreciate it so much. Thanks.